Amen. Please open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 13. 9 months later, we are finishing Hebrews today. We're going to be in Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 7. The author of Hebrews, as he's gone through this, carried us through this study, we're at the end chapter now where he just kind of makes some concluding remarks. And so we're going to finish those up today, and we'll see how some of these things tie in to one another. So I'll be reading from Hebrews chapter 13, starting in verse 7 and going until the end of the chapter. He says, "Remember those who rule over you, who have spoken the word of God to you, whose faith follow, considering the outcome of their conduct. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be carried about with various and strange doctrines, for it is good that the heart be established by grace, not with foods which have not profited those who have been occupied with them. We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest for sin are burned outside the camp. Therefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered outside the gate. Therefore let us go forth to him outside the camp, bearing his reproach. For here we have no continuing city, but we seek the one to come. Therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls, as those who must give account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you. Pray for us, for we are confident that we have a good conscience in all things, desiring to live honorably. But I especially urge you to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner. Now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do his will, working in you what is well pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. And I appeal to you, brethren, bear with the word of exhortation, for I have written to you in few words. Know that our brother Timothy has been, whom I shall see you if he comes shortly. Greet all those who rule over you and all the saints. Those from Italy greet you. Grace be with you all. Amen." So there's a lot in there, but I've tried to narrow it down to a few categories. If you have your bulletin, there's some sermon notes in there I would encourage you to look at. The first is taken from verse 7 and then verses 17 to 19. And that's that we are called to remember, respect, and pray for our pastors. In verse 7, he says, "Remember those who rule over you." And most commentaries that I read, they felt that the word "remember" there, that he was specifically talking about pastors who had died, people who had taught you the word of God, people that had been your pastors that have passed away. So we're called to remember our pastors and to follow their positive example. He says, "Hey, let's think about considering the outcome of their conduct." And so in 1 Corinthians 11:1, the Apostle Paul said, "Imitate me just as I also imitate Christ." So even though Jesus is our example, Jesus is our hero, Jesus is the one we are to worship, on this, walking this thing out in this life, we look for human examples, not to worship, not to idolize, not to pretend that they're perfect or sinless, but as believers, we are called to live a life to be examples. It's amazing how many people use some famous pastor's public failure as a reason why they don't go to church. Well, here's some factual information. Most pastors are never famous. Most pastors you'll never hear about. And most pastors go to their grave with a spotless ministry from a moral standpoint. Most pastors do not fail morally. That is something you won't read about in a headline. Why is that? Because all the headlines are about famous people, and they're all about people who have fallen, usually because of pride or ego or something like that. And we cautioned last week about falling in love with people that you don't even know. Talking about famous people like you know them. Talking about famous people like they're your friends. Like I might do if the Dodgers win a baseball game, I might say, "We won last night. We," like I'm a Dodger, you know, but I'm really not. They won't let me on their team. But it's the same thing. And so we have to remember that and respect our examples that God has given us in our lives. So we're to remember. He also calls us to respect. In verse 17, he says, "Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you." Well, this is talking about our spiritual leaders, our pastors of our local churches. And so to the congregation, he says, obey those who rule over you and be submissive. But now to the pastors, he says, they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. That's me. I have to give an account to God for how I lead. And James 3:1 says that I'm going to receive a stricter judgment than you're going to receive because I am a teacher. Okay, so there is a stricter judgment for our pastors as those who must give an account. And he talks about letting them do so with joy and not with grief. And so as your pastor, I'm going to let the Word of God do all the preaching to you on that verse. Okay, and just ask that you would pray about that and to recognize that the reason that you're not always pleased with me is because I'm a sinner saved by grace through faith just like you. Okay, so sometimes I make mistakes. And that's something that we have to recognize, that there are no perfect churches because there's people in all of them. And we tend to mess things up sometimes. But rest assured, there's probably no one else in the church body that recognizes my accountability to God more than I do. Okay, and so I may be thinking a little bit differently from a different perspective about some things than you are. And so if you combine those two things, one, that I make mistakes sometimes, and also that I am thinking about what I'm doing as one that must give an account, that lets you know I can't always do things the way that you would do them if you were in my position. And I am thankful to be a pastor. I'm thankful to be the pastor of this church family in particular. And then he says in verses 18 and 19, so we're called to remember, respect, and pray for our pastors. In verses 18 and 19, this is what he's requesting. The author of Hebrews, he's saying, pray for us, for we are confident that we have a good conscience in all things, desiring to live honorably. But I especially urge you to do this. He wants people to pray for him. I want you to pray for me. I need it. And I'm thankful for our Wednesday night prayer meeting. I'm thankful for those of you that pray for me on a regular basis. I'm thankful for the ladies that meet on Thursday mornings to pray for all of our church body. And I know that they specifically pray for me and my family. And I appreciate that very much. That's one of the most loving things that you can do for someone, is to pray for them, to remember them and bring their name before the Lord and say, I'm praying for you. It's one of the things that we do have to be careful. If we tell somebody we're praying for them, we need to be praying for them. One of the things, you know, when people put out prayer needs on social media or whatever, and people say, you know, prayers, praying for you, make sure before you send that you pray for them, that you are praying for them. And by the way, I don't need any positive vibes to be sent out on my behalf. I need prayers. I need something that matters, because that's become the new thing for people that don't believe in Jesus. They can't say, "I'm praying for you," or they'd have to acknowledge God. So they'll say, "Positive vibes coming your way." I don't need any positive vibes. I don't believe that you can send me any. So I'm just asking that you pray for me. That would really do me a lot better if you'd pray for me to God. And I pray for you. And I'm also thankful that we do have a designated prayer time in our schedule every week on Wednesday that's gone by the wayside in a lot of places. And I'm thankful for our attendance and participation in that. Also thankful that we have a system in place whereby whenever the office is open, Miss Jamie will send out a prayer email once a day to let us know what the needs are in the church family, so that you don't have to wait until you hear it from somebody else or hear it at prayer meeting or whatever. And so if you have an email address and you would like to know what those prayer needs are, all you have to do is let Miss Jamie know in the church office. Please add me to that daily prayer email, and it is a great way to keep up with the urgent needs of our church members. Next, looking at verses 8 and 9, we could have a sermon on each one of these verses right here. We are called to be grounded in our relationship with an unchanging Jesus and His unchanging Word. In verse 8, he says, "Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever." That's amazing right there. He doesn't change. He always is. He's never been created. He always is. He is God. And He's always been the same. He doesn't change. And so we can count on Him. He is stable. If we're looking for something stable in this unstable world, it's Jesus Christ. Because He's unchanging, that means His rules don't change. It means what's right and wrong do not change. And looking at that also with verse 9, he says, "Do not be carried about with various and strange doctrines." He's talking about teachings, ideas. "For it is good that the heart be established by grace." And so he's saying, okay, Jesus is the same. And because He's the same and He's given us His Word, we know what he thinks. We know what God says is right. We know what God says is wrong. So that means that you don't have to get with the times. Now, wearing black socks with sandals is wrong. Okay, but other than that, you don't have to change. You don't have to get into the 21st century. You don't have to say, "Well, you know what? Things are different now than they used to be. This is okay now." It used to be a sin. I used to think it was wrong, but now I'm much more tolerant, and I've realized that really nothing's wrong, and to be accepted by society, I have to be progressive. I have to change my thoughts with the times. That is the world that we live in. But what does God think about that? He is the same yesterday, today, and He'll be the same 10,000 years from now, because He did it right the first time. This book is an awesome gift to us so that we can know more about God than just, "Wow, what a beautiful world He created. Wow, what a complicated human body He made." And we can do more than appreciate His creation and animal life and the beautiful scenery and all that. We can actually know more about Him. We can know what's right. We can know what's wrong. We can know what He expects from us. And that is a beautiful gift. And when we throw that out, our accountability, our absolute truth that never changes, that this is right, this is wrong, this behavior gets rewarded, this behavior gets punishment. When we throw that out, We do ourselves a great disservice when we can't have the Ten Commandments in our school system. When we can't have the Ten Commandments in our courthouse. When we can't pray to God before a football game or some sort of event or whatever it might be, we do ourselves a disservice. And if we discount the Word of God, then who is to determine what's right and what's wrong? You are. I am. And the really cool thing about it is our society says that you and I can have completely differing opinions on the matter, as long as one of our opinions isn't from this book over here. But we can have totally different viewpoints that cannot possibly both be right. But we have to tolerate and celebrate each other's opinions as equally valid. And we have to celebrate each other's conflicting ideas. Because if we don't do that, we get that intolerant, judgmental label. How dare you not celebrate my opinion? So while we do have the freedom to think whatever we want, it's not true that we need to celebrate somebody's opinion that is wrong. And if you're unwilling to be told that you're wrong or to hear the word no on something, then you're not going to be very happy reading the Bible. Because when I read the Bible, I'm told what's right and what I should do, but I'm also told what's wrong and what I should not do. And as we talked about a few weeks ago, when we talked about God's loving chastisement, that was in chapter 12, starting in verse 3, that sermon. And we talked about how it really is loving. I mean, it's not loving to tell somebody that when they're doing something wrong, it's okay, when you know that God's judgment is coming. It's much more loving to be willing to warn somebody and say, hey, look, I love you. I wouldn't be telling you the truth. Don't do that. There's consequences to that. Is it loving to let your toddler touch the stovetop? Or is it loving to say, don't touch that, it's hot and it will burn you? And then when they give you that look of defiance and go like that, told you not to do that. Usually I only have to tell them one time though. But our life is like that, and it doesn't stop when we're toddlers. In Isaiah 40 verse 8, the Bible says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. The word of God does not change. If we approach the word of God with the right attitude, though, it will change us. It changes my heart, and it continues to day by day if we desire to be like God. So if I approach the word of God wanting to be affirmed in how I am right now and to think that I don't have anything else to learn, I'm going to be very disappointed. But if I approach the word of God knowing, God, I'm a sinner saved by grace. I want to be more like you. I want you to change me day by day through the reading of your word. It is amazing how he can soften our heart and change us. Now, we discussed this in Sunday school a little bit today, but we have to be willing to not be popular. We have to be willing to not be liked. We have to be willing to stand alone. We have to be willing to not be in a majority. We have to be willing to just be satisfied with resting in God. We have to be willing to have everyone else think that we're wrong sometimes and say, God, I just want to please you. I'm not trying to please my critics. God, I just want you to be pleased with me. Next, we see that we are called to reject earthly rituals and embrace Jesus alone for salvation. This section in verses 10 to 14, let's look at this, because this is a little bit different in this passage. The altar in verse 10. Remember, our author of Hebrews, we're not told who it is. A lot of people have different theories, but to me it really doesn't matter. God is the author of Hebrews, so I'm not going to waste my life trying to name the human author. I'll find out in heaven one day. But we know that he is a Jewish believer who is speaking to other Jewish believers. And one of the themes of Hebrews is that Jesus is our high priest. And so you can imagine that being immersed in Judaism and that culture for the whole history of the Old Testament. And then the promised Messiah, Jesus Christ, comes and dies on a cross and is buried and rises again the third day. And they've witnessed this, that many of them did believe. But as we're told in the Scripture, most of the Jews did not believe. And so the book of Hebrews is interesting because his audience are Jewish believers, but they, you can tell, they're fighting against their culture. They're fighting against peer pressure from their family members and their friends to go back, to hold on to the past, to do things the old way. And so he addresses that here in this section, this altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. He's talking about those are the altar now from the Old Testament is for unbelieving Jews, not for Jews that believe that Jesus is the Messiah. In verse 11, he talks about how the high priest had to bring in sacrifices for his own sin. And he's saying, you know, that's the old way where the high priest was an imperfect human who himself had sin, but that's not the way we are now. In verse 12, he contrasts that with Jesus, who is our high priest, that he sanctified the people not with the blood of an animal, not with somebody else's sacrifice, but with his own blood. So he's reminding them, let's not forget why we now reject this way. Let's not forget why we have a Lord and Savior who shed his own blood. And in verses 13 and 14, he says, let us go forth to him. That's that Christian community, that group that's willing to stand together, even if there's a majority of society, in this case, the majority of the Jewish population that was against them, that was saying, come back. You can still have the altar and this blood sacrifice from these animals. And he's saying, no, let's leave the old way. Let's leave the unbelieving camp and follow Jesus into his kingdom. We are not here to build a kingdom on earth. We're not residents of this life. So he's encouraging his Jewish Christian audience to recognize and embrace the change that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection called them on for their life. Now, looking at that subject and what we had just talked about with how Jesus Christ doesn't change, how we're not to be carried about with various and strange doctrines, there is a connection between those two about being willing to stand for what is right, about not being political, not floating out a public opinion poll about things to see what the safest position to hold on something is, but to say, Jesus Christ is unchanging. I'm not going to be carried about with strange doctrine if I stay in the Word of God. This is going to keep me true. Not just coming to your church for Bible study, prayer meeting, worship, and saying, well, we have a godly pastor. He's not going to lead us astray. He preaches right from the Word. Well, the only way you'll know that for sure and certain is if you're in that Word. You get in the Word. You stay in the Word. You read it for yourself. I'm thankful that you're here and that you listen to me preach to you. But you can read the Bible. You can understand it. And when you read it for yourself, and there is a false teacher trying to pass a strange doctrine, you're going to get an unsettling spirit in your soul, and it's going to say, this is not the truth. I know the truth because I've read it. And the more you read the Bible, the more you will have that, and you'll be able to hold people accountable. But we do have a sense, part of us that wants to belong, that wants to be accepted, that wants to be part of a group. Peer pressure starts at very young ages, that pressure to be cool, that pressure to be liked by other people your age. It's probably at its height from 6th grade to 12th grade. Just a lot of peer pressure in those years from 6th grade to 12th grade. And it gets a lot better after you're out of an organized school setting, because then you don't have to be around people all the time that are mean to you, right? So you can kind of start picking, well, I'm going to hang out with this group, I'm going to hang out with that group. But the pressure never totally goes away. Well, if you'll be accepted if you think this way. You'll be accepted if you dress this way or look this way. You'll be accepted if you think this way. But we're cautioned here not to worry about things like that. Say, God, I want to please you. You're unchanging. This world changes all the time. Some of us are just waiting for our clothes to come back in fashion and refuse to buy new ones, right? We're like, I know that's going to happen again. And so some of your wives have probably been trying to talk you into getting rid of some of those ties that you have. And you're like, no, one day this is again going to be cool. If your tie takes batteries, you need to get rid of it. You need to get rid of it. But this kind of stuff goes along for your lifetime. This thing about fitting in, and we have to be willing to reject that kind of peer pressure that doesn't come from trying to be like God. And that's why we need to be like the Apostle Paul. He wasn't being arrogant when he said, imitate me just as I also imitate Christ in 1 Corinthians 11:1. He was accepting the responsibility that comes with being a Christian. He was saying, hey, if I'm going to call Jesus Lord, then that means that he's the boss of my life. And so that means my life should overall reflect the life that Jesus wants me to live. He wasn't saying that he's sinless. He wasn't saying that he never did anything wrong. He was just saying that, hey, if you spend that much time around me, you should see a lot more things in my life that Christ would be pleased with than things that he's not pleased with. And so that call is not just to pastors or missionaries or Christian leaders. That call is to all believers. Say, hey, let's be an example. That song that Samuel sang was about a guy singing to his dad. And he's saying, I want to be that man. I want to be like that person. And so on Father's Day, you know, that's a call to all of us dads to say, my kids are watching. Other kids are watching me. They're watching my behavior. The kids in the neighborhood are watching me. Kids at Awana. Kids at church. And say, I want to be an example. I want to be an example to them of what I'm supposed to be. Next, we see that our response to Jesus should be one of praise and worship of him, accompanied by our love for each other. In verses 15 and 16 in particular, therefore, by him, let us continually offer the sacrifice of praise to God, that is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. I'm sure you'll recognize a song that we sang today that was born out of that verse right there. But do not forget to do good and to share, for with such sacrifices God is well pleased. Well, sacrifices are for the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, that the author of Hebrews just encouraged his fellow Jewish believers to leave in the past and trust in the one true sacrifice that Jesus made on the cross. But now he's calling us to offer continual sacrifices. But he's not talking about animal sacrifices. Believers find no joy in dead animals, but in the living Lord. And so he's talking about that if we love Jesus, our lifestyle is going to reflect him and his love. So we don't have to offer sacrifices anymore. Jesus is our sacrifice, and we can pray to him every day, and we can ask him to forgive us of our sins and pray to him about everything. But he's saying this is the best gift that you could give to him, is to live your life like this. The fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. To have an attitude of thanksgiving. That's an act of worship of God. If we live our lives where we're thankful for the life that he's given us, we're thankful that he saved us, no matter what our circumstances are, we need to remember that. That God loves us. That he let us be born. That he died on the cross for our sins and has extended that offer of salvation to us. Even if we have difficulty in this life, even if we have tragedy in our family, even if we have cancer in our family, even if we have abuse or whatever it might be, things that you just think at the time are unbearable and do not make sense. There were times where I'm reading through Job right now in my Bible plan that I have there out there in the Welcome Center, and I'm in Job and Luke right now, and Job has gone through so much, and there are times where he wishes he hadn't have been born. Times where he deplores the day of his birth, where he said, God, I wish that day would have never been, because he's suffering. He's lost everything. He's having health problems. And this is a righteous man, Job. So we know that our circumstances can get really, really bad to the point that on our own we would say, God, I wish I'd have never been born. I wish I wasn't here anymore. But I want to encourage you today that God does love you. That when we think about eternity and how long it is, that it never ends. That however long our life is, it's going to be just a speck of eternity. Even if we live to be 100 years old, we're going to say, wow, that was nothing next to, I'm going to live forever with God. And whatever your circumstances are, I want you to know that God loves you, that He cares about you, that He knows of your situation. He knows every challenge that you have in your life. And He wants to be your Lord and Savior. He wants to be your Heavenly Father. And one of the lies that we're told is, you know, that if we're saved, life is going to be easy. One of Job's friends did this to him. Bildad. I mean, Job had some bad friends on top of everything else. He just had some bad friends. This is what one of his friends told him in chapter 8 and verse 6. He says to Job, if you were pure and upright, surely now he would awake for you and prosper your rightful dwelling place. Prosper. Though your beginning was small, yet your latter end would increase abundantly. This is the health and wealth gospel. It is not something new. This was in Job 8, 6, and 7. Bad advice from a friend who I believe meant well. He's saying, Job, obviously you've sinned and brought all this about yourself because God wants to prosper you and make you wealthy. God never says that. He says He'll never leave us or forsake us. He says that if we know Him, we're promised eternal life in heaven. He says that if we confess our sins, He'll forgive us our sins. That's the truth. And that's good enough. If He promised to make you healthy and wealthy if you got saved, what would our motivation be to be saved? Health and wealth. But the Christian life is marked by sacrifice, tribulation, staying faithful in bad times, standing for what is right when it's unpopular. It is a difficult life. And a life that as believers we ought to not want to trade for anything that this world has to offer. Because it's also a life full of joy and blessing and a promise of eternal life in heaven. So if we love Jesus, we're going to worship Him out of thanks. We're going to love others because Jesus has changed our heart. I just want to read verses 20 and 21 as we close. It says, now may the God of peace, who brought up our Lord Jesus from the dead, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you complete in every good work to do His will, working in you what is well-pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let's pray together. Dear Lord, we love You. We praise You, God. We thank You so much for dying on the cross for our sins that we can be saved. God, I pray that everyone in here knows that You love them, knows that You died on the cross and have already paid the price that is sufficient to save everyone from their sin. But God, You have left us with a choice. Do we want a relationship with You? If we do, you require that we confess our sins, that we confess you as the Lord of our life. God, that we place our faith in you. God, we know that our salvation is 100% from you. But yet you let us decide if it's a life that we want. And God, I pray that if there's anyone here today that hasn't made that commitment, that for whatever reason has held back and said, I'll do that later. God, that you'd let them know that today is the day of their salvation. When we recognize what is being offered to us, Lord, a personal relationship with God, why would we choose to put that off another day? We don't know if we have another day. God, I pray that if there's anyone here right now that doesn't know you, that today would be the day of their salvation. God, for those of us that are saved, I pray that right where we're at, God, that we would pray about these things that we've talked about. God, our attitude, our relationship, our following of our spiritual leaders, our pastors. God, that we would think about our relationship with other people, the stands that we have taken or not taken, the time that we have or have not spent in your word. God, if we find that our opinions on things have gone soft because of this world, if we find that we're making it up as we go along instead of looking to your word for answers, God, I pray you'd convict us of that, that we would turn towards you and that we would be willing to be corrected by your word. God, we pray that you'd get the glory today, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand.
O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior.